Welcome to Math Homework Hotline, where we do the math with you. I am Canella Prado, and with me tonight is
Carrie Shawshack. And tonight, our theme is,
can they guess it?
I bet you they can. It's Valentine's Day.
Lots of love out here. Our love of math, right? It's our love of math. So, while we love math, we love helping you with those math questions. So, you need to call in right now. And the phone number is 813-840-7260. Again, that's 813-840-7260. Call in with any question, or you can be live on air with us. But just by calling in, okay, just calling in, you're going to get your name put into a raffle to get one of our wonderful vintage Math Homework Hotline t-shirts.
Wow! Mm-hmm.
So get on the phone and call in. And besides besides calling us, we are available on Spectrum Channel just for one night only. We are on Spectrum 636 and Frontier 34. Just for tonight. Next week, we'll go back to our regular channels. But always, always, we are available live stream, which the easiest one, there's a few, but the easiest one to remember is www.mathhomeworkhotline.com. So give us a watch, give us a call. Let's get those questions going. Our wonderful teachers are back there right now waiting to talk to you and help you with your homework tonight. So with that being said, maybe Carrie would like to talk a little bit about our topic.
So tonight, we have a very exciting topic. It is geometry, specifically area and volume.
All right, let's see that graphic. There it is. Are you a lover of geometry?
I love geometry. I love 2D geometry. I love volume. I think it's a lot of fun.
Yes, I myself was not a natural at geometry. And so if you're a kid who's not a natural at geometry, I understand. You should, so give us a call and we'll be here to help you out. I found the best way to learn anything, Carrie, is by teaching it.
I agree. I think that that is so beneficial for our kids too, when they teach each other.
And you're gonna see, I'm probably gonna do a thing or two tonight that I stole from Ms. Shawshack right here.
I love it.
I happened to be very fortunate several years ago to get to teach a couple periods with her throughout an entire quarter, and we happened to be in a geometry unit, and I picked up some things that I thought were amazing.
That is true.
I'll give you credit together when I do them tonight.
Thanks.
Okay, so next up, well, get your phones out, because you're gonna need to take a picture of our challenge question tonight from Mathnasium and EdGems. And then remember, we'll talk about what you win in just a minute, but the first caller will be our big winner of the night. So with that being said, let's get that challenge question rolling. I hope you like cylinders.
I love cylinders.
All right, Carrie, would you like to read it?
Sure. So tonight's challenge question is, what is the height of a cylinder with a diameter of 6 8/10 meters whose volume is 198 meters cubed? Please round your answer to the nearest hundredths.
That's right. Okay, and that's a, I'm going to give a hint. You know, Maggie used to get on me about this, but I find, especially with geometry word problems, if you can draw it,
yes, for sure. I always draw the picture
and label it. Drawing and label it really helps. Okay, so I'm excited to get that started. But let's do a little warm up just to talk about what is. Oh wait, no, I'm sorry, getting ahead of myself.
Well, we need to show our
we
prizes.
We gotta show what they're gonna win. I mean, my goodness, what's the point of winning if you don't know what you're gonna win? Carrie, take it away.
All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna show you. The first thing that we have here is the Mathnasium certificate that's good for a free diagnostic assessment. I cannot talk tonight. That is one thing that you would win. An awesome Mathnasium water bottle. Thank you to Mathnasium for sponsoring us. Of course, you have to have your very own vintage Math Homework Hotline t-shirt, so that is in our bucket. You have this fabulous, this has our new logo. It is the bag with Math Homework Hotline on it, so a little bag to carry all of your things. I love these little bags.
I think it's great for like gym clothes.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, perfect size.
We have a little die. We have some pencils, some sticky notes, and then we have a couple of games. We have Canoodle, which is a really fun brain teasing game. and we have a deck of playing cards. So you get all of these prizes if you are the winner of our
math. Oh, and don't forget the big
one. Oh, I forgot the big one. How could I forget
it? The big one.
And this is our Gemmy Award. Ooh. And with that, Ms. Prado.
Yes, so they, what will happen is if you call in and you win.
Ms. Prado may or may not have been the winner of this.
I have in the past, yes. Okay, so the Gemmy Award winner will get your name engraved here, all right, and your school's name. So, and this is a heavy-duty, nice plaque.
It's a really nice plaque.
Right. And so with that, before we get into our topic, I'm so excited about our topic that I almost like cut through all the good stuff. We have to do some shout-outs. How about last week's winner? Yeah?
Yeah.
Let's start here. I think we have a couple of winners because our show was not live last week. So let's look back from the winners from the show on February 2nd. We have our 13th Student Gemmy Award winner. Let's see if we can get his photograph up. I know we have one.
Oh, there he is.
Yay! There's David from Miss Hunt's class at William Middle Magnet. Congratulations, David. And I believe we also have possibly one of our Math Homework Hotline oversized pillow winners. If you look at our set,
oh, yes.
We have some giant, there it is. We have a couple on our set tonight too. And this is someone special to you, isn't it, Ms. Shawshak?
That is one of my students, Miss Addison. That is in my classroom actually.
Oh, yes, you said she donated it back to the classroom.
She did. She wanted us to have it so that we could use it in the classroom to sit on the floor or whatever.
Some alternative seating.
Yes, some alternative
seating. It certainly is big enough. It is a great, wonderful, and we want to thank Jen Barlow here on the set and her mama for making those for us.
They are so precious.
They are wonderful. Okay, so let's see what else. We have so many winners. Oh, let's talk about, there's this lady. Oh, I hate to admit it.
I think I know her.
Yeah, I think I know her a little bit, too. Those kids back there, though, they are phenomenal. that would be me, less made up for stage. And I won the January Teacher Challenge at I'm Miss Prado from Walker Middle Magnet. And I won a great big bag of manipulatives from AI. Yes, it was fabulous. And my kids, as usual, were excited for me to win anything. That's my third period right there. Shout out to third period. Look at EJ. He's hilarious. All right. Okay. So currently, we're going to talk about next. Currently, the teacher with the highest combined number of phone calls during our three February shows will be our next Teacher Gemmy winner. Now, do you remember me talking about this last week, Carrie?
I do remember that.
So the teacher will get one of these. And the kids will all get their favorite thing besides math.
It is food.
They're going to get a gift certificate to Chipotle or PDQ, someplace all the kids love.
For sure.
And those growing middle schoolers are always hungry.
Always.
Always hungry. All right, so let's see. What's up next? We're ready to do our warm-up. I finally get to do my warm-up that I was so excited about. All right. So,
we do have a second Gemmy Award.
Yes? Do we have a photo of him? Okay, so.
And that looks like another student from Ms. Hunt's classroom.
Yes, I don't know that we have a name. I'm looking, I'm trying to find his name. He is definitely from Williams. And I'm sorry we don't have his name right now. That makes me sad.
But definitely from Miss Hunt's class,
and he
so congratulations.
Job. Okay, all right. So we are going to now go over on to my warm-up, okay? I guess we have a caller on the line. Let's see, I think I'm talking to Camille.
Yeah, hello.
Hi, Camille. Would you like to work with me in the warm-up?
All right.
Okay, so Camille, I'm going to talk about area versus surface area versus volume. Okay, so if we'll go to the board, I've got some little notes written down, but I'm going to talk about a cylinder. Can you see this? It's a blue cylinder. Do you see that on TV? And a cylinder is made up of, and I drew a net of it here, two circles and a rectangle, right? So the difference between area is how many square units to cover a 2D shape. Think of coloring or painting inside of a circle. Like I pulled the bottom off of this cylinder here. So this one has a hole in it, obviously, but pretend it did not. So you would be doing the whole surface of this, okay? So area is just how many square units to cover a 2D shape. So think about coloring inside the lines. That's a good way I like to think about it. And then to find the circle's area, it would be pi r squared. Now, the difference between area and surface area is how many square units cover a 3D shape. So we went from a 2D shape of just a circle to a 3D shape of an entire cylinder, okay? In this case, it's a cylinder. There's lots of 3D shapes. Can you think of another 3D shape?
Pyramid.
Yes, that's a good one. All right, so when you think about the surface area, what I like to think about is if you were wrapping a present and if you could like suction it on and didn't need extras to fold over. Or like painting the outside, like if you were gonna paint the whole outside of this. And so surface area is the area of all the shapes combined together to make a 3D shape. So again, here in this cylinder, there would be two circles and a rectangle. See that?
Yep.
Okay, so then we have the formula for finding the surface area of a cylinder, which is 2 pi r squared. So I'm going to ask you a tough question, Camille, but I think you might get this. If we know that one circle is pi r squared, why do you think the surface area of a cylinder's formula is 2 pi r squared?
Because it's...
Why does it need that 2 for the circle?
Because it's 3.
Because there's two circles on here, right? There's a top circle and a bottom circle. So there's that. So there's going to be two circles, and then it's going to be 2 pi r times height. And the reason why is you're like, but it's a rectangle. Isn't that just length times width? But most often when we're talking about a cylinder, we have no idea what the length is. We know what the height is usually. We can measure that. But it's kind of hard to measure something that is round, right? So, but we know that if we open this up, that the circle here, the edge of it all the way around, would create that length, right? Do you know, do you know what this is called when you go all the way around a circle? It's got a name for all the way around the edge of the circle. Starts with a C, makes an S sound. It's okay, it's been a while since you probably hit this. It's called circumference. So the circumference creates the length. All right? So what do you think volume is? How would you describe volume? If we know that area is just a 2D shape, the area that would cover that you'd use to cover the inside, and surface area is a 3D shape, you like you're painting the outside. What do you think volume is? What do you think that is?
So since we're working with a cylinder, I'm gonna like to think about it as a soap and the volume is like the water.
Yes, right, exactly. It's what goes inside, right? How much volume what would fit inside of here? Like we could pour water in here and that would be the volume. So it's how many units fit inside of a 3D shape. Think about your water bottle. The volume is what is inside. And for the cylinder volume, it's 2 pi r squared, which is the area of a base, which the base of a cylinder is a circle, times its height. So you did an excellent job with me, Camille. Thank you for calling in. All right, see you. Thanks for calling in. All right, I think we already have another caller.
Fantastic.
I think we're talking to Sahasra. Sahasra, are you on air with us tonight?
Yes.
Okay, would you like to do a problem with Ms. Shawshak live on air with us?
Yeah.
Awesome. All right, take it away, Carrie.
All right, this is awesome. So I have a question on the board that we're going to work on together. And it says, find the area of the circle. We are going to use 3 and 14 hundredths, or 3.14, for pi. So do you remember the formula that we used to find area for a circle? Awesome. So that's right, we're gonna use area equals pi r squared. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna look at our circle and we need to figure out, the r stands for radius. Do I have a measure for the radius or do I have the measure for the diameter?
The diameter.
Good, So what does that mean? How am I going to find the radius?
Divided by 2.
Awesome job. So in order to find the radius, we're going to take our diameter, which was 22, and we're going to divide it by 2. And so when we do that, our radius will measure 11 centimeters. All right. Thank you for that. So now what we're going to do is we're going to come into our formula, and we're going to substitute 3.14 for pi. And then we're going to substitute 11 to the power of 2. All right, so 11 to the power of 2 is 121. And Sahasra, do you know the next step? We're going to go ahead and multiply.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to multiply 121 by pi. Do you know what that answer is? We can do that multiplication here off to the side if you want to help me out with that. We've got 1 times 4.
4.
Good. And 1 times 1.
1.
And 1 times 3.
3.
Good. And we're going to add our 0. 2 times 4 is?
8.
Good. And 2 times 1 is?
2.
And 2 times 3?
6.
Perfect. We're going to add our 2 zeros here, and I'm kind of making a mess here of my problem. 1 times 4 is?
4.
1 times 1?
1.
And 1 times 3?
3.
Thank you. And now we're just going to add. 4 plus 0 is?
4.
And 1 plus 8?
9.
And, of course, plus 0 is still 9. Sorry, I got ahead of myself there. 3 plus 2?
5.
Plus 4?
9.
Perfect. And then 6 plus 1?
7.
And then we have 3. Do you remember where we put our decimal? This is a throwback to 6th grade math.
Two from the left.
Perfect. We're going to go 2 from the right-hand side, and we're going to move left.
Yes.
So that's going to be 379, and we're going to say that this area is approximately 379.94 square centimeters. Remember that our units for area are always squared. Thank you so much for doing the problem with me. I really enjoyed it.
Great job, Sahasra. I like to say, and I stole this from a friend who now works over in Orange County in Florida. She used to say, area is squareyard, just in that voice.
Oh.
And it's something about the goofy, silly voice that just resonates from kids. I can just say, area, and the kids will chime in, is squareyard.
I yes. like that. I might steal that.
It's silly, but it works. Okay, so we're going to start to see some stealing over here, right from the start. Remember I told you that I stole some tips from Ms. Shack. Oh, I think we have a caller, though. We'll get back to the stealing. Hi, Arian. Is this Arian? I think it's Arian.
Yes, it's me.
Yes, it is you. Good to have you. All right. Are you ready to do finding the area of a trapezoid?
Yes.
Okay. I'll help you out a little bit, okay? First of all, it says find the area of the trapezoid below. And then it says shows the trapezoid, and we have all sorts of measurements here. At the top it says 9 feet. What might be the height, I'm guessing, is 7 feet. Then down here at the bottom it says 14 feet. And on the right and left, there are left side is 10 feet and the right side is 12 feet. Now, I went ahead and see how I wrote area and then I made a tiny little trapezoid. Do you see that there?
Yeah.
Okay, so I stole this from my good friend here that does the show with me. She taught me to put the shape next to what area you're solving for, because when you get into composite shapes, you need to remember which shape you're solving for. But our shape is not composite, but this is a good habit to get into for the long run when things get harder, and they will. But today we're just sticking straight. The area of the trapezoid is this formula. Ready? Equals 1/2 b1 plus b2 times height. The H stands for height, and then B1 and B2. Do you, Arian, have any idea what B1 and B2 might be? What do you
No.
Okay, so you know how in a parallelogram you have a base and a height? Or in a rectangle you have a length and a width? Well, here we don't have just one base. We have two, right? Because in a parallelogram or a rectangle, they're the same size. But here, they are not. So what we have to do is we have to add our two bases together and divide them in half to find an average and then multiply it up by the height. So if you see, it's very similar to the parallelogram, but not exactly the same. All right, so I'm going to show you what B1 and B2 are. They're just like, think about if this was a rectangle, it would be the top and the bottom. Now, you're going to say to me, how do I know which one is B1 and B2? I'll tell you this. Ready? It doesn't matter. It's the top and the bottom. Label them however you want. And the reason why is because they're added together. And the commutative property says that whether it's 9 plus 14 or 14 plus 9, same thing, right? What is, so that's that. Now, which number do you think, can you see the picture? Which number do you think of the trapezoid? Of the pink trapezoid?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, which number do you think is the height?
The height?
The height of this trapezoid. How tall is it? What's its height?
Well, okay.
No, that's a good guess, but actually 12 and 10 are put in here as distractors. They are. The height is the distance between the two bases, always, for every shape, including 3D ones. The distance between the bases, okay? So we're going to start plugging in numbers. This is going to be our height, all right? So we're going to start plugging in numbers. We're going to have 1/2, and then our B1 equals 9, and our B2 equals 14, and our height equals 7. Okay? Now, what would PEMDAS tell us that we have to do first?
The parentheses.
Yeah, do you know what that is right off the top of your head here? Got some mental math working tonight?
Yes, it's
23. Okay. All right. Now, what I would do next is go ahead and multiply 23 times 7. If these were even, I would do something different, but they're both odd numbers. So 23 times 7 is 161. Now, there's two ways to do this. You can either multiply 161 by half or divide it by 2, because I keep saying in my class over and over and over again, multiplying by half and dividing by 2 are exactly the same thing. So do you know what 161 divided by 2 is?
60 divided by
2. Mm-hmm. That's a good way. He said to round down. I know that 60 divided by 2.
It's 80.5.
Yes, he did it. He said, well, 160 divided by 2 would be 80, and then 1 divided by 2 would be 0.5. But then we have to remember our units of measure and that area is squared. You did a great job with that math at the end. He was just spitting it out, and he thought of the round down and separate into the two parts. Amazing job, Arian. I'm super proud of you. Have a great night. All right.
All right. So
you have something fun for us?
I do. I have a rhombus. So we're going to go ahead, and we're going to look at the whiteboard, look at the question, and this time, though, it's a little bit different. We have... If this was drawn a little bit better, you would see that one of the lengths is going to be longer than the other, but I'm not an artist, so I did the best that I could. But what we've been given in this problem is actually we've been given the area. So now, Ms. Prado, we're going to try to find the length of one of the missing dimensions. So
I feel like you're going to need a formula for that to work.
I think we should definitely use a formula. It's always so much easier to go ahead and write our formulas down. I always tell my students, make sure you write your formulas because your formulas tell you exactly what you're going to do.
Don't skip it
and just follow the formula. It's going to tell you what you need to do. So for a rhombus, we are going to use the formula of 1/2 D1 times D2, which that's super weird. We have not had a D at all, but D just stands for diagonal. As you can see, there are two diagonals that are cut through the middle of the shape. So this time, like I said, I was given the area. So I'm going to go ahead and where the A is, I'm going to substitute in the 30. And then I'm going to bring the 1/2. I'm going to go ahead and put in the number that I know, and we're just going to pretend we're looking for D2. Doesn't matter which one, because again, just like with addition, multiplication is commutative, so it doesn't matter which order we do it in. So I know that 1/2 of 6 is 3. We have our little D here. And then in order to find what diagonal 2's dimension is, I'm going to have to divide both sides of my equation by 3 so I can isolate that variable, going back to our one-step equation work. When I divide this side, they cancel out, and I'm left with just the diagonal 2. And then 30 divided by 3 is 10. And my units of measurement are centimeters, so our answer would be 10 centimeters would be the length of that diagonal. It wouldn't be squared because we weren't finding the area, we were already given the area. And that's how you could use a formula to help you find a missing side length.
Awesome. You decided to use a formula, which is awesome, but when you start moving into 3D figures, a lot of kids will do better with what is called a net. Okay, I showed you one when I drew the square, the rectangle with two circles to represent the cylinder. Well, now I'm going to try to show you one here. And if we can go to my board, I'm holding it together by the skin of my teeth here, right? Okay, so there we go. I've got it. So it says find the surface area of this figure. Okay, now I brought a real life one in. This should say centimeters. And of course, I've only got one hand and I can't get the lid off. Isn't that the way it works? All right. So this is centimeters, centimeters, okay, and centimeters. All right. Believe it or not, I found an 8-centimeter box and I cut it up so that kids could see literally here on the air what I'm talking about with a net. So what we're going to do is we're trying to figure out how many sides are there to this cube, because we know it's a cube because it's made up of totally squares because they're all 8 centimeters. See how it's 8 centimeters in length, width, and height. Mm-hmm. So what we have to do when we do this is make a net. See how I made a net? Woo! And I made it up. There we go. Turn it around. Okay, so as you can see, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 squares. Just like I said, there's 6 sides to a cube. And here I have 6. And when you lay it out, I have 6 squares all together like that. Now, I like to tell the kids, if you don't have a net right in your hands like me, this fancy net that I made at home, you can think about the 6 sides. You've got the front, the back, the top, the bottom, and both sides. See that? So you can think about each shape individually and just add them up. You can come up with your 6 different shapes. So I have written on here, I don't know if you can see or not, but this is obviously the front when I closed it up, right? This would be the front. This one's the back, okay? These two panels here are the sides. See how they're the sides? And when I close everything up, this one here is the top. So I didn't make that up. It really is front, back, sides, and top. Right. Okay, and bottom, and bottom. And I've even labeled them here. I don't know that you can see it, but it says front, bottom, side, side, top, and back. Now, we know that each one of these sides is 8. I'm going to try to see if I can do this with an Expo marker, because that is not showing up. Okay, so 8 here. Oh, yes, that's much better. 8 here. 8 here. Every single one of these sides is going to be 8. So what I'm trying to do is break this down into a much more simple thing way of looking at it. Instead of thinking it as, oh my gosh, all these different shapes, just think of each one individually. Each one individually. And I stole this from Carrie too. Are you ready? So whenever you do a shape, we know that this square is going to be side squared or length times width. Mm-hmm. Same thing, because in this case, length and width are both 8. So side squared means 8 times 8, and that would be 64. And then my good friend Ms. Shawshek said, circle it. Circle it so you don't confuse this number for what these numbers are. When it's circled, that means that's the area of that shape. So then again, I'm going to do this over and over again. Because 8 times 8 is the side squared, or length times width, okay, for each one of these. So as you see, because this is a cube and they're all the same, we're going to get a 64 in every single 2D individual shape. Now you're saying, okay, great, we got all those together. Now you just simply, you don't overthink it in any way at all. You're just going to take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 64 times 6. And when you do that, I guess I could do this longhand, but it is going to be 384 centimeters squared. So, but you could do it longhand over here if you wanted to. 64 times 8 would be, let's see, what am I doing wrong here? Oh, silly me. Caught my mistake. I'm so proud of myself. There we
go.
That was good. That was good. 64 times 6. Miss Prado, I picked up this number 8 when it's 6 shapes.
And that happens a lot.
Yes.
When you transpose the numbers.
That's why it's good to say, is it reasonable? I had that moment of like, is it reasonable that there would be 8 sides to a cube? No. It's reasonable that there are 6 sides. So when you do, you're going to get 8, carry the 2. 384. See, I checked it. I had the calculator math done, but I went ahead and checked it longhand too. And did you notice? When I did it longhand is when I caught my mistake.
That's true. I think that sometimes doing it by hand, you really can double check yourself and you can catch mistakes that the calculator sometimes doesn't.
Yes. Yes, exactly. All right.
All right. So, hey, Miss Prado, do you think we could give away some shirts?
Yes, let's give away shirts. Who's getting them tonight?
All right. So we're going to give away our fabulous Math Homework Hotline t-shirts. And I have winner number 1 is Aubrey from River Hills, Jaciel from Bonito, and Isha from Orange Grove. Congratulations. Woo! So excited for you to get your very own Math Homework Hotline shirt. Wear it to school with pride.
I got so excited about that cube and my, you know, bringing in my prop. But
oh, I love
I kind of skipped the problem, so we're going to go backwards here in a minute. But anyway, I want to just, first of all, just take a little brain break. Because we need to thank the people at EdGems who create who create our wonderful curriculum here in 6th through 8th math. That includes 6th grade, 7th grade, and some 8th grade as well. So what tonight's featured item is the student lesson, okay? So this is like the hard version of your book, but it's online, which is so much easier on your back, can I just say that, rather than having to carry around that textbook?
Sure.
But as you'll see, you can see that there's a QR code. This is new and exciting this year, okay? So wherever you are, whether it's in the hardbound book online, or in some of the workbook pages too, they have a QR code. And what you can do there is you just scan that QR code and it'll bring up an immediate little mini lesson for the student. This is great for students in case they leave their textbook at school or in their classroom. Every student is found on the printed textbook and online program begins with the introduction of the targeted learning concept. The lesson includes definition of keywords followed by clear step-by-step model examples of how to work through the mathematics of the learning objective. Now, I'm going to tell you what I love for this, okay? This is phenomenal in case a student has been absent.
Yes.
That they can see a mini lesson, or the parent who's trying to help. The parent who's trying to help. I know that before I became a teacher, I knew how to do math, but sometimes how to explain it to someone else could be a little complicated. Like, I know how it's done. But this lesson will help you with that and get specific instructions on how your children are being taught in the classroom. And that is a great, you know, quick reference rather than, you know, hopping on TikTok or YouTube and trying to type in the right thing.
Right.
Because you could spend an hour looking there for the exact lesson. This, you just scan that QR code and yourself, the whole family can take advantage of that. So thank you to EdGems for sponsoring us and that great student lesson.
And you know, my students actually have used that QR code right in the classroom.
Yes.
They love
it. Absolutely.
They're very
tech-savvy. And, you know, sometimes just hearing someone else's voice say something makes a huge difference, right? Like, we say it, and then somebody else's voice or a different presentation will click all of a sudden.
For sure.
So the more resources, the better, I
agree.
Say. All right, so we haven't had a challenge winner yet. Don't give up. Call
Keep going.
In. Call in. All right, let's see that question one more time.
All right, our challenge problem. What is the height of a cylinder with a diameter of 6.8 meters whose volume is 198 meters cubed? Can I give a hint?
Yes, please.
All right.
It's time for a hint.
So listen, if you guys were paying attention when I did the question with the rhombus and we were looking for a missing side length, this is the same type of question.
Maybe a formula?
I would start with my formula and I would substitute in everything that's in there.
Yes, and I believe that I have done the volume of the cylinder on the show and showed that
very recently.
Exact. Mm-hmm. I showed that exact formula. So
stick with it, guys. You've got this. We can't wait to see who's going to win.
Never give up. All right. Do you have a problem, Ray?
I do have a problem.
Woo-hoo!
So let's go ahead, and I'd like to look at the board. And sometimes we're given problems where it's not a straightforward area question, but mm-hmm. we want to find the area of a portion of a diagram. And so this, I always tell my students, in real world geometry, it's not nice and neat. They don't just throw a rectangle or a square and say, hey, find the area. Like, you're given something like a wall, and you're having to find the area of a wall so you can put wallpaper up or to know how much paint to buy. Or a mural, absolutely.
This looks like it could be a mural of four mountains.
Right, and these were supposed to really be skinny triangles, but again, I'm not an artist, so we are going to do the best that we can here. And we're gonna go ahead, and we have a caller who's gonna work with us.
It looks like it's Mateo. Is this Mateo? There he is. Is this Mateo?
Yeah.
Hey Mateo, how about a composite figures area question? I feel like you
okay.
can. Yeah, he's like, all right, let's give
he's
it a
like,
go.
He's like, I've got this.
He's
all right,
like, let's give it a go.
So let's go ahead, let's look at the board, Mateo, and let's see what we can do. All right, so how would you approach this? What would be the first step that you would take?
The first step I would take.
That's right. The first step that I would take, too, is I would find the area of the rectangle. So what's our formula for the area of a rectangle?
There we go. Okay.
So we would do area equals base times height or length times width.
Yep. Same thing.
Right? Yeah.
All right. Good. So what was our base and the height for our rectangle? That's right. We have 14 and 20. Good. And they're inches. I don't know if you can read that or not, but it does say inches. So we're going to go ahead and do this multiplication. And when we multiply 14 times 20, what do we get, Mateo?
Okay, so 14 times 20?
Yes.
Oh, that would be 280?
That's right. That would be 280, and our inches will be squared. So that is the area of the entire rectangle. But we have to remember, we're only finding the area of the shaded portion. So now, Mateo, let's go ahead and let's figure out what the area of these four triangles, what they would be. Do you remember the formula for the area of a triangle? So it's the formula is 1/2 base times height, or you could do base times height divided by 2. So we are going to take the height of our triangle is the easiest to find because it's going to be the length of our, or I'm sorry, it'll be the width of our rectangle. So we're going to do 1/2 of 14 multiplied by, and we have four triangles. So we're gonna divide the 20 by 4 to figure out what the base is. And it doesn't matter if we put the the measurement of the height where the base is, because again, it's multiplication and it's commutative. So 20 divided by 4 is?
20 divided by 4 is 5.
Good. So the base of each of our triangles would be 5 inches, and our height of each triangle would be 14. And I'm just drawing this in just so we're a little bit more precise and we know that they're all the same. So I'm going to substitute 5 in here. And Mateo, let's go ahead. Let's take half of 14. What is that?
7.
Good. And 7 times 5, my friend?
35.
Good. So now we have now found the area of one triangle, but how many triangles do we have?
4.
So what can we do to find the area of all 4 of these triangles combined?
You can do 35 times 4.
Absolutely, that's what I would do. 35 times 4, it's much more efficient than adding. So 35 times 4 is going to give us
140.
Perfect. So we now have 140 inches squared, which represents the area of all of these triangles. Our entire rectangle had an area of 280 inches squared. So now how can we find the area of just the shaded part? All right. That's right, Mateo. We're going to take the area of our rectangle and subtract the area of the 4 triangles, and that's going to give us, look at that, 140 inches squared. Thank you so much for working with me. You did a great job. Ms. Prado should be very proud of you.
I'm always proud of Mateo. Mateo is one of my very hardest working kids.
Awesome, I can tell.
I mean, he doesn't give up. He sticks with it, and I'm proud of him. All right, enough Mateo love for tonight. What is the night of love, though?
We should
take a moment to appreciate our students, who we love very dearly.
And I do. I love all of my kiddos at Lutz.
That's right.
Got to give a shout out to you. I said I would.
That's right. And my periods 1 and 2, since I covered period 3 earlier today. All right, so we're going to talk about a parallelogram. And this is very similar in sort of a way to our challenge problem, in that you have to work backwards to find an answer.
Oh.
Okay, so a parallelogram has an area of 40 inches squared, because area is square area, and the base of the parallelogram is 12 inches. Okay, the base is 12 inches. What is the height? All right, so I know that the area of a parallelogram is base times height. So let's plug in what we know. I'm gonna rewrite it over here. Area equals base times height, just so I can work down. I'm a little bit, I just prefer that method than going to the side. All right, so the area of the parallelogram is base times height. Our area, we know it, it's 40, right? And our base, we also know it, is 12. And then we don't know the height. That's what we're trying to find out. That's literally says, what is the height, all right? So now what we are going to do is, this is a one-step equation. And so we have to isolate h, because again, we're trying to find out what is the height. So how do we isolate h? List a little tiny equations review here. Whenever there is a number in front of a variable, it's called a coefficient, and a coefficient is always multiplication. So an inverse operation would solve this. So the inverse operation to multiplication is division. So if we divide both sides by 12, that would be 12 divided by 12 would become 1h, or just h. And then 40 divided by 12 ends up with a beautiful fractional answer of, hold on, 3.3 repeating. That's right. 3.3 repeating inches, or if you want to be fancy and throw down a fraction, 3 1/3 inches equals the height. So working backwards isn't terrible.
No, I think it's kind of like a puzzle.
That's why I'm saying, kids at home, get this challenge question. Don't give up on this challenge question. You can work backwards to find that missing part with your formula.
Absolutely, and we've given you a lot of hints, so please
right.
Keep trying.
And you don't have to just call in to work to give us the answer to the challenge questions. You can do any of the questions we're doing tonight, or just call in and get some help with your homework.
And periods 2, 5, and 7, you guys had homework tonight, so my kiddos should probably be calling.
My kids had a quiz as well tonight. So again, don't forget to call us there at 813-840-7260. And we're on Spectrum 636 tonight, Frontier 34, and call us. Give us a call. All right. Do you have something fun?
All right.
You do.
I think that this is kind of fun. We're going to work with a three-dimensional figure. And again, whew, my artwork is not so hot.
Okay. I love pyramids. Do you know why? I think it's the easiest net to draw.
Oh, they are the easiest. I love drawing the net of the pyramids.
And we have established strongly that neither one of us is known for our artistic merits.
And I kind of feel like when I draw my nets, they look like flowers. So it makes me very happy
when
I do
that. Yeah, me too. I feel that way too, like a poinsettia or something.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I love that you think the same way. All right, so we have this pyramid here. It is a square pyramid, which means that the base is a square. And then it also tells us that each of the triangular sides are going to be the same. So I love questions like this because I feel like they're just very efficient. We can use multiplication to help us get the answer in a rather quick way. So we're gonna start, I like to start with the base. I don't know why, it's just kind of how I like to start. So I know that to find the area of a square, I can do side squared or base times height or length times width. So side square, I'm gonna substitute in 12.5 or 12 5/10, and I'm gonna raise it to the second power. When I do that, I get 156 25/100 feet squared. So now the next step is I need to find the area of the triangular faces. And when I think of surface area, Ms. Prado was doing some really great ideas about the painting and the outside. I just think of gift wrap. I think of birthday presents, and I think of wrapping this pyramid. And that's going to take gift wrap to go on the bottom and each of the sides to cover the whole thing so somebody can't tell what I bought them for their present. So I'm going to find the area of one triangle. I'm going to start there, and again, we're going to use our formula of 1/2 base times height. And the base of my triangle is going to be 12 1/2, or 12 5/10, and the height is 8. Now, multiplication is commutative. I like to do things that keep my life easy. So I'm going to take 1/2 of 8, which is 4, and multiply it by 12 1/2. And I don't have my calculator handy, so I am going to do my multiplication off to the side. 4 times 5 is 20. 4 times 2 is 8, plus 2 is 10. And then 4 times 1 is 4, plus 1 is 5. So I get 50. So the area of one of my triangles is 50 feet squared. But I have to remember that I have 4 of these faces. So I'm going to do 50 times 4, and that'll give me the area for all 4 of those faces. And 4 times 0 is 0, and 4 times 5 is 20. So the area of the triangles, 4 triangles, equals 200 square feet. And then I'm going to add the area of my square. So now, and I'm just going to erase this little side math here, we're going to take 200 and add it to the area of the base because we, again, thinking about gift wrap, we want to wrap the whole shape. So we've got 5 plus 0 is 5. 2 plus 0 is 2. We drop our decimal. 0 plus 6 is 6. 0 plus 5 is 5. And 2 plus 1 is 3. So the area of our shape is 300. Surface area, excuse me, is 356 25/100 square feet. And I love finding surface area. I think it's really fun.
Yes. All right, we have a challenge winner.
Yay!
Hi, Asher.
Hello.
Hi, you're from Miss Ferguson's class at Williams?
Yeah.
Great job. All right, so let's go to the board and solve this guy because we're running out of time on this show. So what is the height of a cylinder with a diameter of 6.8 meters whose volume is 198 meters cubed? Yeah, because unlike area, volume is cubed. All right, so
right.
Volume equals pi r squared times height. Is that correct? Is that how you started out, sort of?
Yes.
Now, do we have all of these things? Do we have the radius?
Yes.
Well, we have the diameter, right?
Yeah.
And the diameter would give us the radius. How does the diameter give us a radius?
Divide by 2.
Divide by 2, yes. If we take a diameter and divide it by 2, that'll give us a radius. So let's start plugging in numbers. We'll use 3.14 for pi. Do you like that?
Yeah.
Okay, and then if we take 6.8 and we divide it by 2,
we get
3.4. That's correct. So we've got 3.14 times 3.4, that quantity squared, right? And then what's our height?
So our height is 11.50.
Okay, okay, all right, so we're finding the height, right? It gave us the volume, though, correct?
Yes.
So that's the number we're missing. So what's the volume? 198, yes?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, this is one of those we have to work backwards on, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so then what did you do next?
So I multiplied 6.65.
Yes, you used PEMDAS and did your exponents first, right?
Yes.
And you got 11.56, I heard you say?
Yes.
And then what was your next step?
Multiply it by 4.
That's right. She's going to combine these two, 3.14 and 11.56, and you got what?
5.45.
Well, no, I think you must have first got a little bit over 36, right?
Oh, yeah.
36 and approximately 3. We'll say approximately, okay? And then, so you have a 36 point approximately 3 times the height, and you would get, and we had to go to the hundredths, so we better put this better than that, right? We better do 36 point, well, no, when you round to the hundredths, you're at 3. You're good. Okay. All right, so now what's the last step? We're at a one-step equation here, so what's the last step? Do we need to divide? We need to do an inverse operation to get the h?
Yes,
we're going to divide. Wait, I always like to put a line down the middle that kind of helps me remember whatever I do to one side, I have to do to the other. Okay, so we've got 36.3. And then our final answer is h equals what?
5.4.
Five, uh-huh. And it looks like we're meters here, right? Woo, meters?
That's a big cylinder,
and that was a big problem. And Asher, you did fabulous. You are our Jemmy winner and won all of the prizes that Ms. Shawshack showed you today. And we'll be bringing those out to your school to get a picture of you doing those. All right, we're running short on time, but do you have something small you can show?
So I want to go ahead and I want to thank our sponsors, Mathnasium, because they are amazing. So be sure to make math a priority this school year and discover why over 1 million parents have trusted Mathnasium to transform their children's math skills and build their confidence. They have live face-to-face instruction. It's offered both in-center and online, so you can go there or you can do it from the comfort of your home. Go ahead and be sure to call for a free assessment now at a nearby location. There's locations in Brandon, Carrollwood, Lutz, New Tampa, Riverview, South Tampa, and West Chase. You can pretty much find a Mathnasium in any part of our county.
I think I'm 15 minutes from 3 of those locations at my house.
Me too.
So they are everywhere. And if your student needs in-person tutoring, they have them both. You can do face-to-face or online, so that's awesome. All right, we have some t-shirt winners. Woo!
Very cool.
Yes, our Do the Math Vintage Collectors t-shirts, and we have Logan from Mulrennan and Brianna from Maniscalco. And don't forget, I think it's Anine, maybe? Does that look right? From York. So I love seeing all these different schools calling.
I love that too.
These will be shipped off to you very, very soon. Okay. Do you have a very small problem we can do in a matter of a minute? Maybe not.
Mine was a pretty big one. Mine was finding a height of a cylinder from surface area.
Oh, yes. That's going definitely backwards. I can do this one really quick. All right, so let's go as fast as we can. First of all, prepare to laugh at my cube. A box has a length of 2 foot, a width of 1 1/4 foot, and a height of 1 1/5 foot. What is it?
Wow.
Yes. That is right there. Miss Johnson's job is safe. Okay, that's our art teacher there at Walker. So we're going to take the length of 1/4 and the width of 2, and I'm going to put it over 1. Do you know why?
I know why.
Tell me why.
So we're going to go ahead and we're going to make 2 a fraction because we're multiplying. And when we put 2 over 1, it doesn't change its value.
That's right. That's right.
2 divided by 1 is still 2.
Right. Exactly. So then the next thing we're going to do is we're going to find the height, which is 1 1/5. I do what I call Ferris wheeling, which is multiply and add, yep, which make it 6/5. Okay. And then you're just going to multiply across the top and across the bottom, and you're going to get 12/20. And can that be simplified?
It absolutely can.
I think it can divide by 4, right?
I would divide by 4.
All right. So then I'm going to end up with 3/5. Does that sound right? And that would be 3 cubic foots. Okay. Foots is not a
foots.
Word.
That was my dog's name cubic when I was feet. Little, actually.
Foots?
Foots.
All right, we're going to go with foots tonight. All right, there you go. 1 quick volume of a cube with the world's best cube drawing.
So let me ask you a question, Ms. Prado, really quickly. Could you cross simplify?
You could. But sometimes I find when there's 3 and kids are just learning, they'll try to do all 3. But you could do, like, change this to a 2 and this to a 1. And you would end up with 6/10, which would simplify down to 3/5. 3/5 foots.
3 foot.
Cubic foots? Okay, all right. That's not a word, children. It's cubic feet. All right, thank you for calling in tonight. Let's talk about what's next. What's coming up next?
So
we're off next week.
We are off next week.
Because we're off school next Friday. So we are off next week. So we won't see you for 2 weeks. There will be a show, but it won't be live. It'll be a pre-recorded show. It'll be a rerun, as we call it. We'll be back Thursday, February 23rd. Our topic is going to be one of my absolute favorites.
I love our next topic.
Me too. Angles and triangles. It's almost like Sudoku puzzles.
It really
is. Can you
see
the
patterns?
It's so much fun. And our theme will be Tampa Bay Lightning. Go Bolts!
Go Bolts!
Yes, exactly. That's also one of our favorite themes here is Tampa Bay natives. Well, I'm not a native, but 10 years now. You are native, right?
I am a native.
There you go. Yeah. So you're Go Bolts, Go Butts,
go Rays.
Yes, well, all of the above. But as we're ending out here, I just want to say one thing. I'm from Kansas City, and go Chiefs. So hopefully Patrick's going to do it for us. Sorry if you're an Eagles fan. My mother-in-law and sister are from there. So
anyway. Thanks for calling in tonight, everybody.
For calling in tonight. We'll see you in 2 weeks live.
Have a great night.
Bye.
Bye.